All right, thank you, Brad. So we're here to talk about identifying slow queries and fixing them. So if you're here to talk about something else, sorry. We're not going to let you out anymore, just FYI. Doors have closed. All right, so first off, I'm Stephen Frost, as many of you probably know, CTO at Crunchy Data, committer, major contributor, do lots of stuff and whatnot. So when I'm not here giving talks and other stuff, I tend to be hacking on Postgres or helping out our clients with whatever. So I just wanted to hit on a quick community slide. I like to always put this out there. Follow Planet Postgres. It's very cool. Lots of really good information. Lots of things about slow queries, right? So if you're interested in, you know, what other people are doing to solve their challenges with certain types of queries and whatnot, a lot of that ends up on Planet. The other one is go join Postgres US. So Postgres US is now very straightforward to go through and join, so I recommend everybody do so. All right, so first of all, we're going to talk about the different ways of finding slow queries, right? There's three kind of main ways of doing that. First thing you have to do is enable logging, and then you can go look at your logs. That's kind of painful and time-consuming, so you want to use something to do log analysis. A great one is PG Badger. We'll talk a little bit about that. And then there's a way to nowadays to view active queries inside of PG Stat Statement. So we'll talk about what PG Stat Statement is and go through some of the different fields and whatnot that are available through PG Stat Statements. And after we do all of the finding of slow queries, we'll go through and talk about exactly, you know, what queries to look out for and how you can improve those queries. So the first thing that you want to care about a great deal is logging, right? These are the kinds of logging statements that you're going to, or logging configuration options that you're going to want to be changing inside of your Postgres config in order to get logging set up. So I'm going to kind of go through each one of these. Some of them I'll hit pretty quickly. If you do have any questions, feel free to ask as we go through. A lot of these are pretty self-explanatory, but definitely ask questions as we go through. So the first one is log min duration statement. This is kind of like your key one, right? So this is the statement, this is the logging parameter that allows you to log queries that have taken over a certain amount of time to run, right? So if you put it to zero, then it logs every statement. This is a lot better than using log statement equal all and log duration. And the reason for that is because if you use log statement all and log duration, you end up with the duration and the SQL statement on two independent lines in the log file. You don't want that. That makes analysis a real pain in the butt, right? Log min duration statement puts them on the same actual line as I show here. So you can see the duration followed by the actual statement. One thing you'll realize with this, of course, is that the duration isn't there until after the, and the statement isn't there until after the statement is completed, right? So the statement runs to completion, so it won't show you a currently running query. It's not until that query finishes and we can pay, put out what the duration was along with the actual statement that you'll see it. One of the other things just to note about this one is that in some environments, particularly really, transactional, very fast, lots and lots of queries coming in, you do run into a difficulty here, which is that if you set log min duration statement to zero, you can just basically end up with a big bottleneck, right? Because all that traffic has to go through the logging collector, and that can end up taking a lot of time and slowing down the overall system. So you don't necessarily want to set it to zero. But if you don't set it low enough, then you aren't going to be seeing those queries that take longer than you want. Right, so that's where PG Stat Statements in particular can be really handy, and we'll talk more about that later. But I just wanted to hit on that as something to, don't rush out to your, million transaction a second database and set this to zero, because you're going to end up slowing the whole system down, and it can be end up being a problem. All right, the next one is logline prefix. So our default logline prefix is absolutely horrible; it doesn't give you any information that you need. So this is what I tend to recommend as a logline prefix, and is also something that tools like PG Badger are expecting, and they work pretty well with this particular one. And this is actually also in the docs for PG Badger, so you can certainly go look at it there. I'm not going to hit on all of these different things that it includes, but it, the important things are things like timestamp, right, and also the process ID, so you know which process it is that this is associated with, because obviously, in a busy system, you're going to have lots of independent Postgres backend processes that are running. Each one of them is going to be logging into the same file, and you want to be able to differentiate them from each other. And here you can see an example at the bottom of what that ends up looking like. Pretty straightforward. So checkpoints. Something that people don't often realize when it comes to Postgres performance is checkpoints can have an impact on your performance. Particularly if you're checkpointing very, very frequently because you're running out of X log segment or wall segments, right? So this is something that you want to enable is log checkpoints so that you can see when checkpoints are happening, how long they're taking, why they're happening. Really important to consider that whenever you're looking at the performance of a particular Postgres instance. What's really helpful here is that you also get a bunch of statistics regarding what happened during the checkpoint, like how long it took to run certain operations, like how long it took to sync all the different files, how long we spent actually writing things out to the kernel, right? So writing things to the kernel is one thing, syncing them is another, right? So syncing them is actually getting them out onto the reliable storage. One of the things you want to look out for here is you don't want checkpoints starting because of wall or because of running out of xlog, right? You want checkpoints to be happening due to time. And so you'll see here it says checkpoint starting immediate force wait. That's just because I ran a checkpoint command, which is fine. It works, whatever, for illustration. But what you really want to see is checkpoint starting, and then you want to see it say time, right? Because you want it to be based on the timing rather than based on the, you know, anything else really. Connection logging is pretty straightforward. Obviously, you want to know when connection started and stopped. Another thing you want to care about a great deal when it comes to Postgres performance in general is just making sure that you don't have like constant reconnections, because Postgres ends up being kind of slow when it comes to that, frankly. It takes a lot of effort to set up a new connection. So you want to be using some kind of connection pooler in an ideal world, or have a really good application that behaves very well when it comes to minimizing the number of reconnects that it does. And this also has, you know, some information about what each log, what happened to the log connection. Anyway, log lock waits, this is also really important, right? So queries can end up being slow because of locking, right? Log lock waits is really, really cool when it comes to this, because after the deadlock timeout fires, so whenever a query runs and acquires a lock, right, if we have waited on that lock for more than a second, which is what's set by deadlock timeout, we're going to go run a deadlock detection routine that's going to basically say, okay, is there any deadlock in the system, right? Because we want to identify any deadlocks that exist, and if a deadlock exists, then we're going to end up having to do something to resolve the deadlock. But the big thing here is that when that deadlock timeout fires, we also can log all of the information about what the lock is that the current process is holding or that it's waiting on, right, and who it's waiting on. So this becomes very, very helpful going through and identifying, okay, these are the lock waits, these are the processes that are involved in this particular locking situation. So one of the problems that you run into with queries is that they end up blocking. You can go look at your Postgres log to see if a query ends up blocking for some reason. And this goes all the way down to row-level locks and things that are blocking due to those. This will not tell you information about internal locks inside of Postgres, but those are, you know, should be very, very short-held locks. You shouldn't even have to worry about them in general. Only on very, very large, highly transactional systems where you've got lots and lots of different processes running would you possibly have contention over those locks. I'm talking about things like the extension lock and things like that. Temp files, right? Another big one is logging of your temp files. So log temp files equals zero means that every time a temp file is created, we're going to log it. Right, this makes a big difference because when you have queries that are running for a long period of time, oftentimes those can end up being cases where temp files are getting created because it's doing some kind of big on-disk sort, right, as a great example. And that can be an indication that maybe you need to change a parameter like workmem that we'll talk about later in order to not use up all these different log files, or temp files, rather. Because using temp files means that we're writing stuff out to the kernel, and that's a lot more work than just writing something into memory somewhere. Log auto vacuum min duration. This one is about logging auto vacuum activity. So sometimes what you can run into is something's happening on the system and it's vacuum running, right? And vacuum sucking up resources, making the rest of the system slow down, potentially. You don't want to disable auto vacuum, right? I strongly recommend against disabling auto vacuum. What you want to do is tune auto vacuum so that it is not impactful on your environment, right? And on your ongoing front end queries. So the way you can identify whether it's having an impact is to log it, right? See what it's doing, see how long it takes to do things, and then you can start stepping things back as needed. So there's some tuning parameters that you can set for auto vacuum and for vacuum to say, don't go so fast, right? Slow down. And you can tune it so that the auto vacuum takes some amount of time, but that's okay because it just needs to scan through the table. This got greatly improved lately in very recent versions of Postgres because we have the ability with the visibility map to have in 9.6 and up, we're going to have a bit in there that basically says we don't need to go vacuum a certain page because it's all frozen. So that's gotten a great deal improved in 9.6 and above. All right, so if you want to, you know, let's start talking about PG Badger. So PG Badger is very straightforward, right? All you have to do is install it. Once it's installed, you can run it on a particular log file, and you can get some pretty fancy reports out of it, which is very straightforward. I think at this point I had a, oh, that's not, this is what I get. I was going to pull up a website to show you the reports, but I don't think it's going to work here because of the setup that I've got that I just changed over from. So, tell you what, I think what we're going to do, we're going to step past that, and we're going to start talking about PG set statements, and then I'll come back to it. So, PG Badger, basically what it does, though, just to give everybody understanding, is that it scans through your log file and generates an HTML file, right? Very straightforward. So you have a nice HTML file that you can go read through and understand how it's working and what it's doing. So, like I said, I'll come back to that one, though, and it'll look and show you what it looks like. So PG stat statements, though. This is something that people should really care about because it's really, really neat. In order to install it, you have to set it up in shared preload libraries. So you set that up using to set shared preload libraries to PG stat statements and then restart. You can't just reload. You have to actually restart Postgres. And then after you've done that, you go into whichever database you want to be setting up PG stat statements for and run this statement, create extension PG stat statements. Right? And what that will do is that'll create the extension and it'll create a view called PG stat statements inside of your current working database that has all of this really useful information. So what this is going to do is for every query that's run, we're going to actually be able to see the user that ran it, which database, a query identifier, right? This is not something that you should necessarily like assume is going to always be the same across multiple versions of Postgres. Generally speaking, I don't think we've actually changed it yet. It should be stable across a given major version of Postgres, but it could change between major versions, right? I don't think it has yet, but be forewarned that that could happen. So whether you want to depend on it or how you want to depend on it is up to you, but something to consider. What it does allow you to do, though, is that because you have that query identifier, you can do roll-ups based off of that, right? And look at a given query and do tracking over time of how a query's performance changes. So also included in here is the actual query text itself, which is actually like a normalized structure for it, which is one of the things that's really cool about PG stat statements is that you'll see the query and any constants that were inside of the query that may have come from your application are removed, right? And they're just replaced with placeholders, essentially, which is what allows us to aggregate individual query calls into a single row inside of the database. So this calls record is every single time we called that particular query, we're going to increment that number whether or not the constants have changed, right? So the constants can change as long as the query structure itself is the same. It's going to be aggregated into this same row inside of PG stat statements. Obviously, we also have total time, which is pretty important, and you can take total time and divide it by calls to get your overall average, but we also track the min, max, mean, standard deviation, right, and the number of rows that came back from the query. Anybody have any questions about any of that with regard to how PG stat statements works? It's a very, very useful tool for identifying what queries are causing problems and being slow. The other stuff that it tracks is block hits, right? So shared block hits are cases where we went to go find look for a block and it happened to be in our shared buffer cache, right? So those are shared hits. Local block hits are cases where it actually was a local, some kind of local block for us, right? Temp files, stuff like that. And then we've got temp files in here as well explicitly. And then we have block read time, block write time, which gives you the overall amount of time that we had to spend doing block reads and block writes, which is pretty, I mean, this is interesting information if you're looking at things on a block level. Obviously, you want to have your shared hits be up as much as you can because that means it's all in shared buffers, which is going to generally be faster. But, you know, maybe it doesn't have to always be in shared buffers. It just depends on what the query is doing. If it's a very large query scanning a lot of stuff, you don't necessarily want to have all of your shared buffers get blown out by it. like a large sequential scan, which we have mechanisms in place to avoid that. So here's an example. So here you can see the query ID, which, like I said, it's like a hash of the query itself. And here you can see the query text. And like I was saying, there's placeholders. So those question marks are the placeholders that are put in place instead of constants. So those constants are gone. We don't have any constants in this actual query plan. You just have placeholders instead. And you can see what the calls are, total time, and all of that stuff. So it's pretty straightforward. You can see here that one of the big things that kind of stands out here is the max time, right? So the max time on this one was 142, which would have been, should be milliseconds, right? So it's going to be 142 milliseconds, which is quite a while, right? Particularly for such a simple query, right? And what this indicates is that there was at some point something happening on the system that ended up being, you know, causing this particular query to take an excessively large amount of time. What that's probably going to be due to is that this particular query ended up having to do a lot of work, like a lot of I/O, because the background writer wasn't able to keep up. And so we're actually having to go do modify this block and actually go push that block out and the write-ahead log records associated with it out to disk ourselves. And that means we have to actually do that sync in the foreground where the actual process is running instead of letting the background processes handle it. And that sync can end up being expensive, right? Particularly when the I/O subsystem is very busy. So here's another one. This is a straight select. So here you can see that the min time and max time and the mean time are all very consistent and very small, which is fantastic. We like this. This is the kind of thing we really like to see. And it's, you know, part of which is because it's just a select query and it's a very simple one, right? So that's always very good. That's what we like to see. All right. Understanding why queries are slow. So obviously Postgres configuration issues can be part of it, or you can have possible bloat in your environment. That tends to not be an issue unless you have bad query plans, and we'll talk about that, because that's the other big thing that you can run into, right? Or query plans that end up causing the system to be slow, or causing the query to be slow, rather. So first of all, when it comes to Postgres configuration, these are kind of the principal configuration parameters that I would argue that you want to be thinking about when you're looking at query tuning, right? So how many people are familiar with all of these? All right, we got a few. Okay. How many people know what WorkMem is? Okay, all right, that's better. So let's talk through a couple of these, right? So I'm not going to hit on them too hard, but what I want people to do is ideally ask questions if I, you know, am going too fast or if there's anything in here that doesn't make sense. Please speak up and ask me so that we can, you know, make sure everybody has an understanding of what's going on. So WorkMem is the amount of memory that Postgres believes that it can use on a per-node basis inside of a query plan, right? So for example, if Postgres needs to do a sort, right? We just, you know, you asked for an order, you did a select with an order by, we have to sort the data, right? Postgres is going to use up to WorkMem amount of memory to perform that sort, okay? If the sort is going to require gigabytes of space to do the sort, right, your WorkMem is not going to be set to gigabytes, typically speaking, and what's going to end up happening is that we're going to do an on-disk sort, right? That tends to be very painful, so you want to avoid really big sorts. There's a lot of cases where maybe you want to sort, you know, 100 or 1,000 records or maybe 10,000 records, though, and you end up with this threshold, right, where WorkMem is set to 4 megabytes or 16 megabytes, whatever you have your WorkMem configured for, and what you're sorting ends up being just a little bit bigger than that, right, or at least Postgres thinks it's going to be a little bigger than that. So it's kind of, you know, so it's one of those cases where, well, we're going to end up doing some amount of disk I/O, right, because we're going to end up pushing at least some of that out into disk because we can't fit it all into memory, and that may be a case where you want to consider upping WorkMem instead, right? And you can identify that through looking at your query logs, right, your Postgres logs with log temp tables, right, or log temp files. You can see cases where those queries end up writing out things to temp files, and you can say, okay, why is that query doing that? Should it be? Can I change that? One of the ways that you can do that is to increase WorkMem up to a point where you no longer see that happening. Now, the downside of increasing WorkMem is that your queries use more memory, right? If you have lots and lots of concurrent connections and they're all using a lot of memory, then you run the box out of memory potentially. That's not good either, right? So there needs to be a little bit of tuning back and forth. What I typically recommend people do is set WorkMem up higher for specific queries that you know require more memory, right? there's a particular query that look that you know you've analyzed that query and you know that it runs a lot faster by having, you know, 64 megabytes of work mem, then you can set that on the fly from, you know, just on that one connection. You can just say set work mem equals 64 megabytes, run the query, and then do a reset work mem, right? And it'll reset it back to the default. So you just have that adjustment for that one query. So I'm going to run through the rest of these pretty quick, but maintenance work mem, for example, is just how much memory we use for building an index and other kinds of maintenance tasks. Effective cache size is how much of the database Postgres can kind of think is in memory, right? So a lot of what Postgres has to do is decide whether or not to do a sequential scan or to do like an index scan, right? An index scan is all random access. Right, so you don't necessarily want to do an index scan if you're going to be going through the entire contents of a table, right? You want to do a sequential scan instead. Now, there's a balance there of, well, how much of the table, right? Well, okay, that balance is impacted by how much of the table is probably already in memory, right? And that's what effective cache size is going to impact, right? The larger the effective cache size, the more likely something's going to be in memory already, and that's going to make Postgres think that a random access isn't as expensive, because there's a potential there that that random access will actually be hitting something that's in cache already, right? And if it's in cache already, then it's not very expensive. It gets expensive when we actually have to go all the way out to disk and pull it back. Everybody following along? So effective cache size is never actually allocated, right? So you can set that to, you know, half the memory in the box, right? If your cache seems to generally be about half the memory of the box is used for cache, you can set it to that. It's not going to hurt anything. We're not going to actually try to ever allocate that memory. Shared buffers is another really important thing. So shared buffers is how much memory Postgres has for its own cache, right? So effective cache size is more about the Linux kernel's disk cache. Shared buffers will actually be allocated by Postgres and is how much memory Postgres is able to use for its own disk cache. You don't want to set this too big. You don't want to set it too small. It really takes some tuning to figure out what the right answer is. In an ideal world, you really want to set shared buffers to a bit larger than what you would call your working set. Right now, the working set is different for every platform, for every application, as to what your working set actually is and how big it is. It requires some analysis to figure that out. But that's where you want to set shared buffers. Generally speaking, you can get away with setting it to a few gigs, and it's fine for a lot of different platforms and applications. Checkpoint segments and min-max wall size all just reflect how much disk space Postgres can use for the write-ahead log. That's relatively straightforward. Checkpoint timeout is how frequently we do a checkpoint. And checkpoint completion target is what we want to try to do, how quickly we want to complete that checkpoint. So I'm not going to hit on those too much, but if you have questions, feel free to ask. All right, dead bloat and tuples, or dead tuples and bloat, rather. Another problem that you can run into is that you end up with a lot of bloat in your tables, right? Bloat in the tables is bad. The way that we address bloat is by doing a vacuum. So we scan through all of the tables and mark any areas in those tables that are now reusable, right? That's the whole purpose of vacuum. So that's why you want to make sure the vacuum and auto vacuum are running on your system, because you don't want to end up without, you know, if you don't run vacuum, then we never mark any space as reusable, right? Even though you delete a whole bunch of records, it's not reusable until a vacuum is run. Right? Once the vacuum's run, that space is reusable. And that's how you can end up with a lot of bloat in your tables, is the vacuum isn't being run frequently enough and you're doing a lot of updates and deletes. Remember, every time you do a update in Postgres, it's actually an insert and a delete. So something else to be aware of. Another thing is that indexes can be bloated too, right? Indexes particularly get bloated when you end up with random or very wide key space usage. Right, UUIDs are a great example of a really bad thing for indexes, right? Because what ends up happening is that it's completely random data going into that index, and it ends up spreading it out all over the place, right? And if you're doing a lot of updates and inserts and deletes with UUIDs, that ends up being pretty expensive and can lead to bloat in your indexes. It's not something you necessarily want. Well, I don't want it. I think it's pretty bad. Check Postgres is pretty useful. I definitely recommend using something like Check Postgres or Check Postgres to be able to do this kind of monitoring and analysis. It's got some interesting tools for identifying bloat. I think some of the other tools, like pgstattuple, is a great one for actually getting real information. So the check Postgres check is kind of like it's a guess. Like, we think there might be bloat here, right? Based on some statistical information that we gather. It's a very fast check, but it's a guess, right? So used it to kind of identify places where you should go look to see if there's an issue, but actually do things like a proper vacuum and look at the stats from that, or something like pgstattuple and go look at the stats from that to see how much actual bloat you have in your table and in your indexes associated with it. In order to actually get rid of all bloat, you have to either cluster or do a vacuum full, typically speaking. There are some corner cases, but we're not even going to get into that. But generally speaking, you want to, if you really want to get rid of all bloat, you have to do a cluster or a vacuum full. Not all bloat is bad, though, right? Bloat can be good because that means that you have space in the table where you can actually insert new records, right, which are either coming from a regular insert or from an update, and that's valuable. That way you don't have to extend the table. Extending the table is expensive, requires a heavier lock. If you have a lot of independent processes trying to write into the same table, that gets particularly bad because that lock can have a lot of contention around it. Newer versions of Postgres are better about that and are able to extend more than just 8K at a time. Older versions had a bigger issue with that, but it's still a heavier lock that you probably don't want to do unless you have to. So some bloat is good, right, at the end of the day. All right, so now let's talk about how things work in Postgres, right? So whenever you're running a query, you have a couple of different ways of getting the data out, right? You can either sequentially scan through every record, right? That's called a seq scan operation, which is bulk, right? You can do what's called a skipping scan, right? Or a bitmap scan. What this is a case where we go build this bitmap of locations in the table that we want to go visit. And then we start at the beginning, and everywhere that we said we wanted to visit a location, we go there, right? We scan. And then we'll have potentially large sections where we don't need to scan that data, so we're going to skip, right? We're just going to seek out, you know, we're just going to do a seek and go to the next point in the file or in the relation where we think there's data that's of interest to us. So that's what a bitmap scan does. And that's something that you can get if you have an index, right? You have to have an index in order to be able to do a bitmap scan. If you have an index, we're not going to be able to do a bitmap scan. We're going to have to do a sequential scan throughout the entire table. You can also use an index to pull just specific records out, right? That's an index scan, right? You can also have an in-order index scan, which actually pulls out a lot, you know, basically all of the records from the, you know, based on the ordering of the index. And that can be very fast, although you want to do that in cases where the index is a, you only want to pull out a subset of the table that way. You don't generally want to do that unless you want the entire table sorted. You don't generally want to do that because it's a lot of random access, right? And random access tends to be expensive, especially if you're going out to disk. One of the other things about an index is that an index generally is going to require going between accessing the index and then going back to the heap. There are special cases where we can do what's called an index-only scan, right? So if all of the columns that you are pulling out of your query are in the index, right? So maybe you've got an index across three columns, and that's all you're pulling back in your select query. You're just selecting out those three individual columns. We can potentially do an index-only scan, which means we're just going to go to the index. We're going to pull the values out of the index, and then we're going to check what's called the visibility map to see if the visibility map says that that particular page that the index is pointing to is visible to everybody. So if all the records on that page are visible to everybody, that means we don't have to actually go bother visiting the heap because we have all the data we need from the index and we know that the tuple has to be visible. The way the visibility map is built is through a vacuum, right? So you want to be vacuuming your tables, right? If you don't vacuum your tables, you won't have a visibility map. If you don't have a visibility map, we can't do index-only scans. So there's another part where you definitely want to have vacuum running. And if you have things like insert-only tables in particular, you want to make sure that you're vacuuming those because you want those to have a visibility map for when you're querying them, right? But auto-vacuum won't necessarily go do that. You got to be watching for that and make sure that you're actually getting those tables vacuumed as well. All the information for when tables are vacuumed are available through the stat system. So you can look at pgstat tables to see that. All right. Now, how do we put things together inside of a query, right? We use joins, right? So when you select from two tables and you do a join, right, that's where you're putting those two tables together. There's only a few different ways to do that. You can do that with a nested loop, a merge join, or a hash join, right? Typically speaking, these are the ones that you're going to see, and they're the ones that are interesting. So nested loop, you end up going through, you know, you basically step through one side and then do some kind of lookup. Like you might have an index lookup that you have in, on the inside of it. So for every record, we're going to go do an index lookup, right? Typically, nested loops are not ideal, right? It just depends. Maybe if you're pulling out 10 records or something, fine, right? But if you're pulling out hundreds or thousands of records, generally speaking, a nested loop is kind of painful, right? It works good for small sets, not for big sets. A merge join basically looks at both relations and sorts them, or uses an index to perform an in-order index traversal so that the data coming out is sorted, and then it just walks through them, right? Merging the data together, right? Pretty straightforward merge sort. If it doesn't have, if there's no index available and it has to do a sort, that gets very expensive, right? So if you see a merge join with a sort happening underneath of it, that can be an indication of a problem with your query, or possibly that you don't have WorkMem set high enough, right? So this is another case where WorkMem is really important. When it comes to a hash join, we're only going to do a hash join if we think we can actually fit the entire hash table into memory. If we don't think we can fit the entire hash table into memory, our, you know, Postgres kind of runs home to merge sort, right? And because we know we can do merge sort out on disk because we can go do sorts and whatnot. Yes, Thomas? What's that? Hash join will do batching. That's just bad. At least historically, it's been pretty, I've seen batching go really bad. So hash join can do what's called batching. So you can have segments of the hash table that come in and out from files in order to do batching. But number one, I discourage people from looking at batching or wanting to do batching because in my experience, it ends up being bad, being worse, typically. You want to up WorkMem instead, in my experience, if you can do it, right? If you can get WorkMem to have one batch, that's ideal. The other thing I've seen is that we do go back to merge join pretty quickly if we don't think we can hash join it. It's going to happen, right? So the most recent versions of Postgres have made changes in this area, right? In particular around hashing and how we do hashing that have made it better. So some of this stuff may be only applicable primarily to like 9.5 and below, but be wary of merge joins is kind of what I'm getting at because they tend to be expensive. In general, a hash join is going to be better, but you want to up WorkMem enough so that you can get a hash join, especially if you can get a hash join in one batch, because that's going to be generally the most performant way of doing a large join. All right, aggregation, right? So you can do, you know, there's a couple different ways of doing aggregation. You can do what's called a group ag, which is a lot like a merge join, right? We're going to sort all the data, and then we're going to feed the data sorted into the aggregate functions to do their aggregation. Or you can do a hash ag. This is another case where we're building a hash table, which means we have to be able to fit the whole thing in memory. Now, what we have to fit into memory is the result set, right? The result of the aggregation is what has to go into memory, which can at times be much smaller and typically is much smaller than the data set going into it. So you don't necessarily have to you hopefully won't have to set WorkMem as high, right? So the problem here is that Postgres has a really hard time figuring out how many records are going to be resulting out of aggregation, right? So we don't know. So I've set WorkMem up to stupid high levels before because Postgres's estimate of how big it thought the hash table was going to be was way off, right? Postgres would think the hash table is going to end up being, 16 gigabytes when I know it's only going to be 3 just because I know the data, right? And because of that, I set WorkMem up to 16 gigabytes just for this one case where I've analyzed it, and I know this is going to be the case, so that Postgres does do a hash ag, right, underneath, and it will only actually use as much memory as it needs. So it's not going to actually allocate all of WorkMem. It's only going to allocate the amount of memory that it actually needs to do it, to do the work. So hash ags are good, group ags are bad. So what's the best plan, right? It all depends, right? So the way we figure this out is we gather statistics using analyze, vacuum analyze. It goes into this PG statistics table. Auto vacuum will automatically run analyze for you typically. If you have bad stats, you end up with bad plans, right? And it sucks. So you want to use explain analyze to look at what your plans end up being and also look at what the estimates are from Postgres versus what the actual resulting row counts and things like that are. So you can automate the collection of plans using auto-explain, which is pretty handy, pretty straightforward. It's just like PG set statements where you set up shared preload libraries, and then you can set a log min duration and whether you want nested statements or not to be logged. Pretty straightforward. It is expensive if you turn on the explain analyze option because that literally will just rerun whatever query it was so that it can collect the explain analyze information. and then roll back that transaction. That gets very expensive. So I wouldn't typically recommend enabling that, except if you have a really hard time getting an explain plan for a particular query. All right, we have a number of different ways of analyzing plans. There's, you know, in terms of what the output is, or yeah, explain plans can have XML, JSON, or YAML as their outputs, and then you can analyze those in either pgAdmin 3 and 4, or you can use explain.depez.com, which is fantastic for doing this kind of analysis work. All right, so now let's talk about fixing them, right? So some really straightforward low-hanging fruit items. When you run explain and you say a sequential scan, right, and you only get like one row back and you're not doing any kind of aggregation, that's a very good indication that you want an index, right? You want to be using an index in those kind of cases. If you've got WorkMem and you're seeing sorting or a merge join, you want to be, you know, or if you have a query plan where you're seeing sorting happening or a merge join happening, you may want to increase WorkMem up to a point where you get just a hash join back, right? Or something along those lines, you know, or an in-memory sort. So when Postgres does do a sort and do an explain analyze, you'll see it'll actually tell you when that sort is actually having to use disk and when it's not. If you end up in cases where you have a nested loop, and you know, some of the times the problem can be statistics, right? If you have like a really large data set and Postgres isn't able to figure out that you know this query is actually going to return back a lot more rows than it's estimating, sometimes that can be helped by increasing the statistics target. Now, if you want to talk about statistics, you should talk to Thomas, because Thomas has been doing a lot of work around statistics. Right, Thomas? That's a lie. Yeah. He doesn't want to admit it. One of the other things you can run into are deletes that are slow. Right? A delete can end up being slow because you don't have, you know, because Postgres doesn't require an index, right, to be backing a foreign key cascade delete. Right? So you have a primary key on a table, you have another table that's a foreign key reference to it, and you delete something out of the primary key table, right? If there's no index on the column that's the foreign key from the foreign table, which there may not be because Postgres doesn't require it, that delete will end up having to do a sequential scan on that other table. All right? So this is something you want to watch out for in your systems, because and you want to make sure you have an index on that other table. Right, so that's something you can see if deletes end up being slow and you have cascading deletes happening with foreign keys. All right, prepared queries. If you see that the planning time is significant for your queries, then this may be something you want to consider. I wouldn't necessarily run out to make everything prepared statements tomorrow. It's different from having prepared statements for the purposes of making sure that you don't have SQL injection, which I certainly encourage. But when you're actually doing proper, you know, prepares in order to save a plan, you want to actually look and see, is planning time the reason that this thing is slow, right? There are ways of getting out what the planning time is. Recent versions of Postgres will explicitly tell you how much time was spent in planning when you do an explain analyze. In PG10, we have the ability to also say what the planning time is on for just a regular explain without an explain analyze by turning summary on, and it'll tell you what the plan time is. One thing to watch out for is that when we have this prepared query with prepared plans, is that the first five times you run a query, right, a prepared query, Postgres does this kind of little check to see, okay, would it be sensible to replan this query, right? Would it help make things, you know, would the query end up being much better if we replan this query entirely rather than just planning it, or rather than just using the generic plan that was created? So when you do a prepare, we create a generic plan. But when you actually pass in a value, right, when you run an execute, we're going to take that value and we're going to consider, okay, is it possible that with this new information we have, with the specifics of this information, that a specific query using that value would be much faster? And if it is, we're going to run the specific query, right? And we'll do that for five times. If for five times the generic query ends up winning out, right, or isn't any different, then we'll just always use the generic query. Right, but there's this kind of magic number five in the back end that does this. So if you start seeing things where, like, the first five times you run it, it's fine, and then after that, it, like, you know, you the data changes and suddenly the query is horrible, you may want to re-prepare it, right, or just have some ability to re-prepare that query because that's what's happening. Or just always plan it out explicitly every time. Okay, so let's just talk about some really straightforward queries here. So we're going to talk about straightforward things, right? So like a select count star is very straightforward, but a lot of people end up doing it, right? Well, how do we make a select count star fast? Well, one of the ways to do that is to have an index, right? If you have an index underneath of that table, then a count star will actually be faster anyway, because it'll use an index only scan, right? We still have to go through all of the entries in the index, but at least that's typically going to be a lot smaller than going through all of the records in the table, right, or in the heap. Downside of this, if you don't have a visibility map, we aren't going to be able to do an index only scan. Or if the visibility map isn't current, then even if we do an index only scan, we end up doing a lot of going back to the heap to check the visibility information. So keep your visibility maps current, and this kind of a select count star is pretty fast because it's going to use the index. Of course, there's other approaches, right? You can go create a side table and update it with triggers and whatnot. That certainly works too. It's a different approach. Another one that I see a lot of is people do select star from table, right? Well, do you actually need all of those columns coming back? Where this can be a really big problem is when we're talking about really wide columns, right? A great example is everybody who uses JSON or JSONB nowadays, right? Well, that JSONB blob that you have that's like 10K in size, right? The way Postgres is going to handle that is we're going to take that whole big blob, we're going to compress it, and we're going to store it in another table, right? Because it's more efficient to work with it that way, and that keeps the primary heap pretty small, right? So in the primary heap, we just have a 4-byte pointer, right, that points over to that entry in the toast table, okay, saying where they get that big, long, big chunk you have. What this also means is that if you use select star and you don't actually use that 10K blob of JSON that's coming back, you're spending a lot of time making Postgres go grab that data from the other table, decompress it, stream it back to you, and give it to you, and you don't do anything with it, right? Wasted effort. Don't do that. Generally speaking, I don't use select star at all, right? Don't use it at all, because you want to only return back the actual data that you need to get your work done, right? And of course, if, you know, make sure you're using where clause and conditionals and whatnot so that you're only pulling back the set of data you want too, right? Because that's also how an index is going to be useful. Things like select distinct is something I see a lot, and I definitely tell people watch out for select distinct, right? You don't want select distinct, generally speaking, because it usually is an indication that you are missing a join condition somewhere, right? And so what Postgres is doing is it's doing a big Cartesian product join between these two tables and then filtering them out by basically probably sorting them, possibly not, but could be sorting or could be hashing them, and then getting you down to just the distinct set of tuples. But we're doing a lot of work for nothing, right? The right answer is to fix the query, right? And typically one of the ways to do that to make sure you're not missing any join conditions is to use join syntax rather than comma splicing, right? That kind of comma join, A, comma B, comma C, is comma joining, and it, you know, does this Cartesian product thing. Typically, I recommend that what's down here at the very bottom, which is explicit join syntax, so that you see exactly what your join conditions are between all of your tables to avoid the risk of having a Cartesian product. All right. Another case that we're at is, so more queries, lots of queries we're going to talk about. So this is things where you can do like a select star from X where my ID is in some select my ID from this big table, right? Which can end up being a big set, right? It's typically not a good idea. Generally, you want to turn that into a join, or you want to use something like not exists or exists, right? Those are generally going to be faster. So I typically try to say don't use not in or in, use exists, right? And the way you use exists is with a subquery, right? And a correlated subquery specifically. So that's definitely something that you want to use. If you're doing a not in, you might be able to turn that into a left join, right? If you do use, you know, if you like the vision of it, right? Postgres will typically realize when you use a not exists that what you mean is a left join or an anti join, right? And then it'll go and implement that underneath for you. All right, CTEs. So CTEs are great. I really encourage people using them. The downside of them is that when you use a CTE, what we're going to do is we're going to run that query, and we're going to take all the tuples from that query and store it in a tuple store. Right now, that can be in memory, right? If your temp work mem or your temp mem is high enough or whatever, it's going to be in memory. But even so, the only way to then access the tuples in that CTE is by scanning them. Right, so you don't want to end up with a large data set. Yes. Common table expression. Right. So when you use a with clause, you see how it says with CTE here. Right. As blah. Right. That's a common table expression, which are fantastic. They're actually really great ways to build queries, is using common table expressions. But you have to be wary of it, because you don't want to have like a large data set being returned from a CTE. unless it's something where you actually are going to use all of those records, right? I mean, you have to be careful of it, but you don't want to like return a whole bunch of stuff into a CTE and then filter, right? Because if you do that, then we're going to build this, you know, we're going to run that CTE to ground, build up this big tuple store, and then scan it and filter it all out, right? You want to just filter it from the get-go in the initial query, right? So what I typically do is I'll use CTEs to kind of build up, right, a query from the top to the bottom, but just make sure that you realize how the CTEs are going to be accessed between them. If you want a really, really fast count star, one of the ways you can do that is by looking in pgclass at the statistical information at what's called rel tuples. So it is very, very, very fudgy, right? And it's just completely statistics-based, so it's not going to be perfect. If you want something faster, a trigger-based approach is the way to do that if you want something that's actually accurate. All right, so a little bit of review. Obviously, there's a lot to tuning Postgres. Another big one is partial indexes. So if you're not familiar with what a partial index is, it's where you can say create index, and then you can have a where clause, right? And that where clause will create an index on just the tuples that are passing that where clause or that conditional, meaning you get a much smaller index. It's like people do indexes on Boolean fields, right? Not a good idea. Partial index on a Boolean field, great idea, right? Just do a partial index on that Boolean field for where it's true, and suddenly your index is tiny, right? Because it's like, you know, you're only looking at records that haven't been processed or something, right? And that index is tiny and very, very fast and very, very efficient to work with, right? Don't put an index on a Boolean field where you're only ever caring about one side of the Boolean. Let's put it that way, right? The other thing is that, generally speaking, you want to use indexes when you're pulling out a very, very small set of data, right? Something less than 5% of the table, typically, right? Don't create an index because you want to pull out half the table, right? If your query is pulling out half the table, an index is probably not going to be helpful. And Postgres probably won't use it. One of the other things to do is go look through your stats and see which of your indexes are actually used. Some indexes you have to keep because of the fact that they are backing constraints, right? But for other indexes that are not that way, consider whether or not you really need them. Also, whenever you're creating partial or functional indexes, double check your query plans to make sure they're actually going to get used. Otherwise, you have an index that you're paying to maintain and update and not doing anything with it. All right, so questions. I know that was fast. I know that was a lot. Yeah.
Question about the connection log.
Yes. Yes.
It doesn't show up on the connection statement. That's log only statements following that. I've only seen unknown in the connection.
Yeah, I don't think we actually know what the app name is at that point when that message is logged.
It's a property on the connection.
Yeah, but I think we actually logged that connection message earlier than we parsed that information out and figured that out. So I don't think we actually physically know that information. It's a good question, but I don't think we know it. We might be able to change that. Okay, well, ask on hackers or talk to one of the consultants around here. Yeah.
Do you have a strategy for using partial indexes, like, say, on a Boolean, like, where active, and you know it's going to be a very small percentage of the rotating table? You're not sure what columns you're actually going to be selecting out of that table.
That doesn't matter. You won't get an index-only scan, but it will use the index for just where that Boolean, where that active flag is true.
Even if the column that is actually indexed is not
referenced. Well, you are going to have to include a where active, right, inside your query statement.
Where active, but, an index on what column? The primary key, where active, or?
No. Yeah, sorry. Well, we'll talk about it later. We're out of time. But, yeah, we should be able to use that. As long as the conditional says where active, it should use the index. All right.
Thank you.
Thank you.